Hello everyone, this is Jeevita. The topic which I have chosen is automatic program repair for the software construction research lesson. So let us know what is automatic program repair. The automatic program repair consists of automatically finding a solution to software bugs without human intervention. So by the end of this presentation, you will know how to convert a faulty program into a potentially repaired program. As you all know, the modern software applications are growing in complexity and increasing its size and must also satisfy strict release requirements that may impose short bug fixing and maintenance cycles. So this puts significant pressure on developers who are responsible for timely producing high quality software. So in order to reduce developers' workload, repairing and healing techniques have been extensively investigated as a solutions for repairing and maintaining the software. Also, the Microsoft offers a cash payments for reporting certain types of vulnerabilities. So here is a figure about that. Like even the Facebook software engineer Matt Jones once said, we get hundreds of reports every day and we have paid out over $1 million to hundreds of reporters. So instead of finding and fixing bugs through a stranger, it's better to use a tool like automatic program repair, which would reduce repair costs extensively. So now let me go into the details why automatic program repair is necessary. So it saves time. It reduces the amount of time engineers spend on debugging. We can fix repair programs containing millions of code even without any special coding practices required. So sometimes if the patch is incorrect and the bug was not fixed with the help of the tool, the partial solution is provided as a guide for the developers to fix bug repairs. So previous work has shown that developers address bug repos associated with a candidate patch more quickly than when no suggested patch accompanies the bug report. So here are the different tools of automatic program repairs. So I have mentioned only few of them. So the first one is GenProg, which is the earliest generate and validate bug fixing systems for C programs. Aster is an automated repair library for Java. It contains JGenProg and Java implementation of GenProg. So this Repainator is designed for modern development tool chains based on continuous integration and versioning with Git. So Prophet improves the repair process by exploiting the information available on a large database of software. Sapphix is the new AI hybrid tool created by Facebook engineers and can significantly reduce the amount of time engineers spend on debugging. And RS repair technique that uses random search to guide the fix generation process. So now let me explain with an example how GenProg works. So as we know, human repairs often involve inserting new code and deleting or removing existing code. So GenProg uses those same building blocks to search for repairs automatically. Now consider this Euclid's greatest common divisor algorithm. So this program has a bug. When A is 0 and B is positive, it loops forever on these lines 6 to 10. So this GCD2 variant is actually a patch produced by GenProg, and this would pass for the test case 0,55, but it would fail for other important functionalities. So again the GenProg tool modifies the line since the previous test case failed. So it modifies the lines on 4 to 5 and inserts the code like exit of 0 and A is equal to A minus B. So this is the GCD variant 3. This is the final repair patch. And this is the genetic programming that repairs programs by selectively searching the nearby program variants until it discovers one that avoids any defects and retains the key functionality. So now let me compare with the same example with another three techniques like Tarantula, Ochai and Jacquard. So this is the fault localization mechanism to localize the statements that are likely to be faulty. So this usually works at the level of program statements. So this fault localization technique requires the availability of a test suite with passing and failing tests. So here you can see these are the statements which are marked when for this particular test cases, and when it comes to these statements, when it fails and when it passes. So these are the scores given by the different techniques. So according to these techniques, the highest score is for these two lines, second and third line. So this is where the this indicates that where there is a bug in this program. So this zero means it is least suspicious, and one is with the highest suspiciousness. So these statements which I have highlighted here has the highest score according to these three techniques, like tarantula, ochai and jacquard. So then automatic bug repair techniques have also some limitations. So that would be like it would not give a patch correctness guarantees, and then a weak test suite may cause generate and validate techniques to produce validated but incorrect patches that have negative effects. And then there may be a condition of overfitting where the test suite based program repair generates patches that passed as a test suite but are actually incorrect. Then there are different kinds of overfitting. Incomplete fixing means that only some buggy inputs are fixed. And then regression introduction means some previously working features are broken after the patch. So, and this is the another tool called Sapfix, which Facebook has developed. And this Sapfix scans the code and automatically identifies bugs, tests the different patches and suggests the best ones that the engineers can choose to implement. So Facebook previously used an automatic bug spotter tool called Sapience. So Sapfix can be integrated with the previous tool so that Sapience can be used along with the Sapfix, since it suggests solutions to the problems that Sapience discovers. So here you can see the overview of the Repairnator bot. So how it works, like the Repairnator constantly monitors the test failures happening in continuous integration. So when a test failure happens on the continuous integration platform, the Repairnator gets the corresponding commit and runs the Repairnator tool and finally suggests a patch to the developer as a pull request on the GitHub. So here you can see where we have marked like A. This is the place where the developers commit to the GitHub project, and then the step 2 will trigger the build on the Travis CI. So it, when the Travis CI builds the failing tests, so when this is triggered, the CI builds are given as input to the pipeline that contains three stages. So the first stage is called the continuous integration build analysis, and this is where it collects and analyzes the continuous integration builds from the GitHub projects. And then this second one is the bug reproduction. This aims at reproducing the build failures that have happened on the CI, that is the continuous integration. And the third stage would be patch synthesis. This uses the failure reproduction information to search for patches. So as you can see in this figure, when a patch is found, the produced patches are first analyzed by a Repairnator team, that is the Repairnator patch analyst. So if she finds the patch correct, then she proposes it for the original developers of the project to fix the bug. So these are the steps involved in fixing the works using repainter board, which I explicitly mentioned here, whatever I explained in the previous slide. And this bot also collects valuable data in this field for the future research. And these are the three input stages of continuous integration build, which I already showed in the figure, like the continuous integration build analysis, bug reproduction, and then the patch synthesis. So now, what are the information needed in running the automatic repair program? So the location of the source code is needed since it is used for synthesizing the patch, and it contains the file names and the line numbers pointing to particular statements. Then the names of the failing tests. It is important to directly give the names of failing tests to the repair tool in order to save the time of re-executing the entire test suite. Then the failure type. So the failure type is like example null pointer exception or assertion error. This is used to select the kind of repair tool to use for the patch generation. Then the location of the compile time and the runtime dependencies of the project. So that is, we need to give the whole dependencies of the project to the repair tool in order to perform any dynamic analysis. So the future implementation would be that the IDE should not only report semantic errors at design time, but also suggest code repairs to them. So if the IDE can just suggest the code repairs at runtime, it will be very useful for the developers to get the bugs fixed easily. So we could use some kind of abstract interpretation to formalize the concepts of a verified repair. This is the one which removes bad runs while possibly including good runs. There are many software repair techniques which are available. However, there is no clear picture of the findings. So this is often due to the mix of innovation. So we need to get clarity which strategy and heuristics is best suitable. So now this is the time to summarize. So we came to know how to convert the faulty program into a potentially repaired program using different steps of fault localization, variant creation, and the variant validation. So we also came to know why this automatic program repair is necessary. That is like to save time and reduce repair costs. So this reduces the workload for developers significantly. And then we saw different tools used in this automatic program repair, like the earliest one which started in 2009, like Genprog, and the modern open source tool like Repainter Bot. So then we also compared the scoring for fault localization using different techniques. And then we also saw how the bug fix process happens with the Repainter Bot. So now you have the understanding of how the automatic program repair actually works. So now let's dig deep into the main research challenges in this field. So that is like it would be real world practicality, like how quickly the bot find repairs, and then how many lines of code they can handle, also what sort of programs and bugs they can address. So I have also mentioned a GitHub link to one of the bot that is Repainter bot, and which is also a open source. So if anyone is interested to know how it works, they can try this. So the link is here at the end of the slide. And then if anybody wants to contribute this to this open source, they could do it with this link. And it contains all the details how to use and clone the Repainter bot. So, thank you.